Dick Stroud on low-cost car audio.
Good afternoon. This is a presentation that I gave to SAE and for Smoot-ums. I've changed the text into black and changed the font into Arial, so everybody should be able to see it. And in case you went to the SAE, you didn't miss much because their computer didn't have my font or text color loaded and showed nothing. I got interested in a low-cost audio project because I have a low-cost audio system in my car, and I just came to believe that there had to be a way to make it sound better. I'm going to talk about a little bit about the car. I'm going to talk about some system goals I had for the car, tools that are available if you want to recreate this sort of thing, and some of the listener comments I've had. I think good automobile sound does please customers. I continue to believe that it helps people sell cars if they sit in a car and the salesman has a tremendous quality, high quality sound system playing. I think it gives one a better feeling about the car. Bass systems today, though, are still most disappointing. I'd always hoped that systems would get better over time, and I'm seeing some evidence of that, but not just a whole lot. There's a whole lot you can do to improve the quality of bass audio systems without spending a lot of money, which is what nobody wants to do. What are your performance goals from a low-cost or any audio system? You want proper tonal balance at any listening level. You want a balanced, enveloping spatial presentation. You want a pleasing volume level. It has to be able to play as loud as you like, and it has to have bass. We today enjoy the availability of low-cost digital signal processors that can do all kinds of neat things, and we're going to talk about what those neat things are. Back when I retired, it was just beginning in 2000 or 2001. They were just beginning to get some of these capabilities, and now there's no doubt in my mind that for Dan, you could probably tell me, less than $5 or $6, you can probably get an incredibly powerful DSP.
Sure.
So we need some speaker specification that makes sense, and it still has to be installed somewhat correctly. What are the electronic tools you can bring at such a car? Well, of course, equalization, loudness compensation, power, image positioning is something you can enhance with DSP, and you can enhance the spatial properties. Equalization, everybody's pretty familiar with. It's the peaks and valleys correction so that you have an equal bass treble balance, you have an equal octave to octave balance. All of you are familiar with what equalization does. Loudness characteristic has to do with the human's ability to enjoy the perception of balanced sound, and as Dave likes to point out also, Dave Clark likes to point out, in a car, loudness has a lot more to do with road noise than it does any kind of ear compensation. And if you're driving a Vibe down the highway, I can absolutely guarantee you that that's a fact. A loudness compensation typically looks something like this. This is what this car has in it because that's what the factory equalization looks like. You get nothing down to a certain point, it all comes in rather quickly and then drops down. Now from a psychoacoustic loudness con Fletcher Munson, you know, that sort of thing, that doesn't make any sense. From a road noise point of view, it makes a lot of sense. Power and bass management can be done to improve the perceived characteristics of a car in terms of playing loud and playing full with deep bass. Receiver amplifiers today have 18, 20 watts. I mean, this is just common. Bridge audios, the QBA amp is probably 10% distortion. It's probably, 24 watts or something like that, 22 watts. You can reduce the bass at high volume settings, but it's better to manage the bass. base management is what will be demonstrated in this car, and that's probably the main reason I brought the car, is to demonstrate that. Bass management makes the music sound cleaner, it lowers intermodulation distortion, it keeps the speakers from sounding ratty, and it makes the car sound like it's got a lot more power than it actually does. We need to look at how this works. First of all, what do we typically get in a premium system? We typically get a very wide BL versus X property. And everybody talks about speakers that can do 10 millimeter X max. But in a car, if we get more than about 1 or 2 millimeters X max, we're talking a really good speaker. So when you try to push a speaker like that beyond its limits, more or less, beyond its range, its X max range, it can get pretty ratty, especially if those turns are rather sharp. It can get really obnoxious sounding with a boink, boink, boink. The best song, by the way, to ever get that to happen is a song called, it's KC and the Sunshine Band, Get Down Tonight. That song, if your system can play that without boink, you got a good set of speakers, or you're managing the bass. This car out here is clearly the latter. It is not the former. Those speakers, when I first played that song in this car, were unbelievably ratty. But with the bass management, I challenge you to turn the bass of the radio up, turn the volume anywhere you want it, and see if you can make them do that. The KMS versus X usually is even tighter to keep the speakers from producing too much intermodulation distortion. And in the car, of course, your premium speaker, no problem there, nice and linear, almost linear, and the ratty speaker is going to have this sharper characteristic. You might ask, well, why in the world do they make speakers like that? It's not hard to make a suspension nice and soft. The answer is because you have to put a longer voice coil in there, and you have to allow longer travel to make this over here happen. And when you put a longer voice coil in there to maintain sensitivity, you got to have a big magnet. And name one thing that affects the cost of a speaker. What is bass management? Bass management is done like this, and this is a little bit simplified, but basically a crossover somewhere around 120 hertz. I think this car, I took some liberties with that number. You send the high frequencies out to the speaker as if unprocessed. The low frequencies are low passed by the crossover or by a filter, basically by a low pass filter. It goes into a hard clipper, and actually the characteristics of that clipper really can't be heard. You can change it from analog or soft clip into digital clip, makes no difference. I can't hear a difference. Then you put that, and this is the reason why, because you feed that through a low-pass filter. Now what you're getting is low-order harmonics, not rap, rap, rap. You're getting low-order harmonics. You sum that back in and send that signal out to the speaker, and it's surprising what that does. If you look at a waveform of a kick drum, or even a plucked bass guitar, you get a tremendous peak followed by something a lot lower. Well, if you limit the size of that peak, you think you would take all the impact out of the signal. But remember that the harmonics generated by that thump are still going to be present. It really doesn't seem to hurt it that much. Now, if you A-B it, if you had a set of really good speakers and you A-B it, I guarantee you, you would hear a difference. But you can really pump the bass up ahead of that clipper.
Your low pass filter, is that also 120 hertz, or is that some other frequency?
In this car, I can't tell you exactly what it is. It's somewhere in that neck of the woods.
Theoretically, it would be roughly where your crossover would be.
Roughly. The low pass filter that follows in the car is actually lower than 150, a little bit, not much, or 120. But it's literally tuned to what works the best, what sounds the best. If you allow too many of these clipper harmonics to come through, then you haven't really improved it very much.
Exactly.
So you have to turn it down to where it sounds right. Imagine that. The image positioning is done with two things, and one that's, you know, you've got your time intensity trade-offs you can do side to side with things like having more treble come from the far side. Well, that's hard to do with these little tiny dome tweeters. So I have the mid-ranges actually maintaining treble. I don't low pass the mid-ranges so that some of that treble energy goes across the car, especially in the vocal range. It goes across the car and helps balance the time intensity trade-offs. But Joan Baez doesn't have that many highs in her voice, so how am I going to move her over? The answer is I'm going to do phase shifting. Now, so you say, why not just use time delay? Time delay is great. Time delay is great for the driver. It is horrible for the passenger. With phase shifting of the right frequency and the right cue, it is possible to improve the imaging for the driver and for the passenger. I tuned a car, it happened to be wide enough for a customer, and the big complaint I got from the guy there was, it sounds better for the passenger than it does for the driver, fix it for the driver. And I went, just turn the system around, I guess. I didn't know how to improve it more for the passenger, because it was pretty good but it was razor sharp for the passenger, because we had a center speaker which was taking care of that middle ground. The phase shift gets you up to, what, 200, 300, 400 hertz or something. The phase shift gets you up a ways. The intensity gets you, but there's that mid-range where you're not going to steer that mid-range with time intensity trade-offs with speakers that big. Spatial enhancement, I think, this is something I am particularly fond of. When you go into a concert environment in a good shoebox hall with a balcony, da-da-da, the ambience appears to be around you. Oops. We don't want a software update, Dave. Sorry.
Do it next time.
Yeah. The software, the ambience in a concert hall, there's a strong return from the back. There's all kinds of things. In most listening systems that I've heard, especially two-speaker stereo home systems, unless the room is live, especially if the back of the room is not live, all the ambience appears to be concentrated up front, and that's just not what a great hall does. So I like to enhance the spatial characteristic in a car by putting delayed signal into the back. Now, I don't mean DSP room mode in the back. I'm talking about taking the reverberation in the signal and the direct sound and delaying it about 5 milliseconds. The theory is, and this may be just a wild hypothesis, is that you cannot discern the direct sound coming from the back. You don't hear sound coming from the back. You do sense something spatial coming from the back. And I'm guessing, it's simply a hypothesis, that reverberation, more or less a long-term continuous sound, doesn't do as good a job of masking a copy of itself delayed 5 milliseconds as a single signal does. I have never seen or heard of any theory that says that that's true. It just seems that way when I listen in the car. You can go up to 11 milliseconds without getting too much on your double hits on your sticks and all that sort of thing. If you go much above 10 milliseconds, 10 or 11 milliseconds, you start getting at 18 milliseconds produces a phenomenal delay effect, but it creates an almost an echo kind of situation, and it's just too much. You're not in the fusion range, but for impulsive sounds, they're easy to hear when you're much beyond 11. So I have limited to 5. I haven't really experimented with 10 because I have to splice the bass. I cannot delay the bass in the rear speakers. I have to keep the bass in the rears aligned with the bass in the fronts because that's all the bass production I've got. So I want both of these speakers working together. So depending on what the phase of that 5 millisecond signal is, I've got to line it up, you know, and the filters of course matter too because they're messing with the phase. But you have to line it up so that you don't get a discontinuity as you sweep through that range and thus a phase cancellation peak or notch. I will also tell you that needs to be a fairly high order crossover, because you create a comb. When you take an undelayed signal and mix it with a time delayed signal over that region, it creates a comb, and it can create a very hollow sound that you really don't like. Also important is speaker specification, getting the right numbers on your speaker, putting it in correctly, and getting acoustic properties of your installation in order. Speaker specification includes getting a response to maybe around 40 hertz. I don't think it's that hard to get 40 hertz out of a low-cost speaker system. You need a comb travel versus sensitivity spec of some kind. What I'm talking about there is power compression specification. You may not care whether the compression is due to KMS problems or XMA or BL problems. You just say, hey, when I put this much into it, this is what I want out. Dual cone speakers can do nice things if you really are super low cost. If you're equalizing a two-speaker tie motor vehicle, you might want to go with dual cone speakers. Don't turn your nose up at dual cones. They can do a surprisingly good job. You need to be aware of the acoustics of the vehicle. This is the transfer function, a set of transfer function curves from the Vibe. As you can see, at very low frequencies, the bass is easy to get almost anywhere in the car. If you follow some of these other curves, you see that the front doors, like that light blue curve, is the front door of the driver, of the passenger rather, and the front door of the driver is the yellow curve, which is like the next best curve or something like that. Some of the other curves before you get to 100 hertz are really going down in the dumps. So putting your bass production in the rear, you got to have a lot of power to make up for that. That's a lot of difference. That's tens of dB, 10 of dB. So getting bass out of front doors is a very good thing to do if you can manage the door rattles, and that is a whole task unto itself. The acoustic transparency of the grill, 1.5 dB is a lot to give up just for a grill over the speaker, but any more, we used to have to put carpet over the speakers and what we call windsong over the speakers, which didn't have too much loss, but even a grill, if it's got little holes and tunnels in it, can do terrible things to sound. They should be aimed if necessary to get the better imaging and to get the treble up off the floor. They should be sealed to prevent bass cancellation, which is, again, a little bit of a trick, but it really modern vehicles are, you know, it's not as bad as all that to get a pretty good seal. And they need to be enclosed in an adequate volume, at least equal to the speaker's VAS is a good rule of thumb, I think, but bigger if possible. Another little trick that actually I've seen in a production speaker is to, like in a dual cone speaker, is to put some sort of treble deflector. A lot of times if you use dual cone speakers in a car, let's say I'm the driver, the treble sounds like this. In other words, I get the treble from the far speaker, but this feels like I've got one of Burns' noise reducers in this ear. And the answer to that is to take a little sample of that signal. If you use a popsicle stick, it almost is like a high-pass filter. You don't get but just a little bit of the big wavelength stuff just blows right around the popsicle. So then you go with a tongue depressor if you want more. Or then you go with a paddle, you know, you the wider it is, the longer it is, and all that, it's essentially equalized. And remember, some of this deflector can be pushed down into the cone area as long as the cone doesn't hit it. You don't have to stick it out in front of the grill. You can bend it down, but take a little bit of that treble energy, just a little sample of it, and send it up to the near side to illuminate that ear on both sides. Now we're going to have a listening test set up. It doesn't have the popsicle sticks, but it has. This is very similar to the system that I brought for the Smoobs contest last year, with the exception that those beautiful 12-inch subwoofers in the back and 70 watts on each or 80 watts on each is history. That is not in there. There are 4 6-inch good value speakers optimized by the purchasing department. There is substantial DSP processing thrown at this thing.
No tweakers.
The listening test setup included I didn't have tweeters originally. I do have tweeters in there now. I did put tweeters in there now. I put no tweeters because I wanted to tell you about the test I ran. I did nothing but treble equalization on the, I had four speakers, no tweeters. Okay, I'm sorry, I got ahead of myself a little bit talking about the car as is. The car that I demonstrated had no tweeters, it had four door speakers, okay? The same speakers that you're gonna hear out there. My comments to the listeners was minimized. I had 5% of participants, plus the author, me. I had one train listener, three musicians, and one wife.
What happened to the others? Wives.
Mm. Oh, I don't know. Mm. They probably wouldn't sit in the car. Here's the kind of comments I got. They did not want to leave the test. They really commented on the spaciousness. They said, good, it's back. It's back. The old 6x9s on the back, on the shelf that was way back in the back, had enough time delay that they would give you that effect. He just was thrilled. He wanted this sound in his car. One guy who was familiar with the cost reduction activity on those speakers was convinced that I had changed the speakers because he thought they were a whole lot better than stock. They wanted the system in their home system too, and they wanted a van system to sound like that. I demoed the vehicle in Ann Arbor with no tweeters and no sub in that fashion. And the comment was, I wish our name of the vehicle, which is a lot like a Vibe, but I'm not going to use a commercial name, could sound like this. And that car has the same body, but with a sub and tweeters. My own comments on the car, as was demonstrated at that time, was it has a fairly smooth response. There's missing extension on both bass and treble. Some of that's been corrected. Despite considerable 27 dB of treble boost, I could not detect compression, but I would be very nervous about putting anything like that in production, because if the pilot balance on the FM was off just a little bit, you'd have a screaming 19 kilohertz tone in your ear. So I wouldn't do it, but I did it for this particular car, and I was using CDs as a player. There was a little boominess on the Kokomo song by the Beach Boys, and it didn't have a real full bottom on a low E note. Those are the kind of things. The image was very much on the floor. It seemed to be down low. I didn't try any tricks to raise it psychoacoustically, but it seemed to be low. The image was pleasing. Most of it was spread across the dash. Image is very unfocused. I did not get a sharp, cohesive image. The sound was very spacious. There was no pull to the rear. I found that in one of the seating positions in the rear, there was a strong hollowness because I had a very low order crossover between the low frequencies and the high frequencies. The conclusion is that much can be done to improve the sound of the automobile bass system and what I call near bass system, that is six speakers and a sub. The value position can surely be improved. I do not recommend you buy the cheapest speakers you can buy, but if you are stuck with them, you can do some nice things. The premium system suppliers may hopefully feel some pressure to improve their systems. Thank you for your attention. Do we have any questions or comments? Yes.
Yeah, what kind of processing power is required to make this come off?
I must humbly admit it's a Macintosh. Thank you. Running with Ableton Live and lots of plug-ins and all kinds of equalization. It's very powerful. But I don't believe there's anything in there that couldn't be done in a modern DSP. I know that I've done this very thing in Sigma Studio. Mm. All of that stuff. And it works. And that's for an analog devices chip. Yes?
I'm assuming the listening test was done parked in a driveway somewhere. If you take the car out on the road and you're driving on a highway, how does this system compare to a stock system?
Honestly, I can tell you, I did that yesterday. I drove it from Kokomo, and I hated turning it up that loud. And I only listened to it for a few minutes and had to turn it off because the noise and that vibe. Now, I have done a lot of noise control in that car. I put acoustic labyrinths on the rear extraction vents that were conveniently located right next to the rear tires. I put that in there. I filled all of the available spaces with fiberglass, put fiberglass in grocery bags and put them in around the spare tire, put something like Dynamat right around the wheel wells to try to keep the vibration. And I did a great job on the rear. And now I'm getting a lot of tire road interface noise off the front tires. So it just, it's so loud and so obnoxious that if you're in town, it's great. But on the highway, I can't listen to it.
Okay. As a corollary question, that if you were to do this as standard practice in a passenger vehicle, would you be able to listen on the highway, or would you have the same, I can't listen to it, it's just too...
I have been in cars that don't even need loudness compensation for road noise. I know that it can be done. There are some quiet sedans out there, but my vibe is notoriously... And by the way, guys, just a little side here, rotate your tires. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't know what not rotating tires does to noise, it's just unbelievable. The front and rear suspensions do not resonate at the same place. And so you get pattern A on the front and pattern B on the back. Rotate them often enough and it can't find the same home, so it erases the old pattern and starts the new pattern. And if you just stay ahead of that, sorry you Corvette owners, you can't do that. But any other questions? Yes?
I realize you have some experience in the automotive industry, and some people in the room do. And as far as I know, not many car companies take this kind of approach to improving their system performance. They more tend to throw money at various pieces, as you were talking about, tweeters, subwoofers, bigger magnets, rather than these basics that you're talking about. And you're not talking about any new cutting-edge technology. Everything that you're doing has been off the shelf for 10 years or more. So I'm really asking your opinion. What do you think is missing in the automotive industry? Do you think it's possible? What would it take for a car company to design systems as you designed this one?
A chief engineer with product focus. I really think there's a whole in the early days of General Motors, for example, it was to build great cars, to build, you know, and as Roger Smith later said, is to provide I may be misquoting him here, but I believe it was, to provide a good return for our stockholders. That's a whole different, or maybe it was stakeholders, that's a whole different way of looking at your company. I am very discouraged about working with car companies to try to make better sound. There's a few that are still interested, but they're not domestic. For me, anyway. Some places like Chrysler have their own internal experts. They don't need my help. But there's some other places that, in my opinion, need somebody's help. Any other questions? Thank you for your patience.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.